Good morning. Welcome to Faith Baptist Church. We're delighted that you're here this morning on this last day of April. If you have your bulletin, let's take a quick look at our announcements. We do have a couple of special announcements that need to be made. We want to call your attention to. Scheduled for today is the morning worship service and then fellowship time afterwards and then Bible study. No evening service tonight. We do have special services next week.
Good morning, everyone. Trusting that the surgery and recovery go well for Pastor Chip, in my capacity as church clerk, at the request of the pulpit committee and in fulfillment of my constitutional duty, I am announcing that on Sunday, May 14th, at the end of the morning worship service, there will be a brief meeting of the membership of the church to decide on our candidate, Reverend John Herbert V, affectionately known as Pastor Chip, as our next senior pastor. The Constitution states, with at least 60% of the active membership present, and by 75% of those votes cast, the pastor shall be called. Notice of the meeting shall be given by the church clerk in at least 2 regular meetings of the church prior to the election. This is the first notice. We need every member here next week for the candidates' preaching sessions, morning and evening, as well as the question and answer time, fellowship time afterwards. And we especially need all members here on May 14th to vote. The Constitution also states the vote shall be by ballot. We realize that May 14th, being Mother's Day, is a special day for families. So in order to make the meeting as efficient as possible, we are asking all voting age members to do the following. On May 14th, please see me at the Welcome Center before the worship service. I will give you a ballot in an envelope with your name on it. This way we can make sure we have the quorum of 60% and we can assure that all eligible members and only eligible members have a ballot. Only the envelope will have your name on it. The ballot will still be a secret ballot. After the worship service, the chairman of the pulpit committee will call the meeting to order. The ballots will then be marked by you and collected. Please do not hand in the envelope. After the meeting is dismissed, the ballots will be counted by me, the secretary of the pulpit committee, and one observer. Please spread the word to any members absent today and be in much prayer about this important church body decision. Thank you.
So you can see the feature there in the bulletin as well. Next Sunday is official candidate preaching. And all of this is Lord willing. Surgery is scheduled for tomorrow at 2 o'clock. And we're praying that will be successful, won't be any complications, and that our candidate will be up to it on next Sunday. And so official preaching on the 7th and the vote taken on the 14th. And so I know you're much in prayer, and be supportive of that. We need all of our membership to be in attendance. Schedule for this week, our softball team plays at 7 o'clock. We got our season started with a win last week. That was kind of fun. And we play tomorrow night at 7. Wednesday night, regular schedule, Wana Clubs, Bible study and prayer time. Trustees Saturday morning, and then next Sunday, the special schedule. We do have need some volunteer help cleaning and painting at the various homes that we own. We worked yesterday in 1506, and we've prepped some of those, and they're ready for some painting. If you have some free time throughout the week or can join us on Saturday, we're going to help get those ready. We got an exciting notice this week that Dylan Keener, young man that we extended a contract to for music, helping us with the school and with the church, has accepted and sent back his signed contract. We're very, very excited about that. We have another couple coming to be a part of our church family, and we're very excited about that. So we need to get these homes ready for some new arrivals. Golf outing is coming up on Saturday, May 13th. If you want to golf, if you want to sponsor, if you want to help, we'd appreciate that. And Pastor Chip or Scott Miller or myself, we can answer that. We'll say more about Vacation Bible School next week. And then You notice a special baby shower for the boy baby coming into the Herbert home. And please make note, those are some very special events coming down the road. Let's open our hymn book, sing one of the great hymns of the faith, How Great Thou Art. Hymn number 38, let's sing together.
Hymn number 38, let's stand together as we sing hymn number 38, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Let's pray. Lord, you are great. And Lord, we wait for that day when you will come with shout of acclamation to take us home. Lord, we thank you for that blessed hope. For without that hope, surely we would be, of all men, most miserable. But with that blessed hope, Lord, we can keep on keeping on with our life. We can serve you with confidence. We can witness with boldness. We can face the problems of life knowing that you are in control, that you have a plan that both today and the future are in your hands. And Lord, we praise you and thank you and worship you for that, for your greatness. Lord, I pray today that you would be with this service, with each aspect of it. Lord, help us to worship you in an appropriate way through our singing, through our tithes, through our offerings, through preaching, through responding to the preaching, through our fellowship. Lord, help us to reflect your greatness in all that we do today and throughout this week. Lord, I pray for those who could not be here today because of sickness or other reason. I pray that you would be with them in a special way. Lord, we do pray for Pastor Chip and his surgery tomorrow. I pray that you would guide the surgeon's hands. And Lord, I pray that you would help the healing, recovery to go well. For others who may be facing great challenges, recovery from surgery and other things this week, I pray that you would be with them as well. Again, Lord, thank you for being a great God. Help us to reflect that greatness in all that we do, both today and in the future, we pray in your name. Amen.
All right, let's take our hymnals. Go to hymn number 112, God Leads Us Along. Hymn number 112.
In shady green pastures, so rich and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the water's cool flow bathes the weary one's feet, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long. Sometimes on the mount where the sun shines so bright, God leads his dear children along. Sometimes in the valley, in darkest of night, God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long. Though sorrows befall us and Satan oppose, God leads his dear children along. Through grace we can conquer, defeat all our foes. God leads his dear children along. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through the fire, but all through the blood. Some through great sorrow, but God gives a song in the night season and all the day long.
Thank you. Please be seated.
1 John 4 this morning. If you would turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4. Five short verses and very familiar verses. But even in these five short verses, you can tell why John was called the Apostle of Love. He uses love several times just in these five verses. 1 John 4, starting in verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. 1 John 4, 7 through 11.
What a great passage of Scripture, and certainly a highlight in the New Testament. We're going to sing in response to that hymn number 160, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Let's sing together hymn number 160. And when we get to verse 3, we'll sing a cappella and then have piano come back in on verse 4.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glad
Men, if you come forward for the offering this morning. Brad, I'm going to ask you to pray, please. This last week, we had our junior high competition, and I did not go, but the Lord provided very capable people to take my place, maybe even more capable than me, and it worked out really well. And one of our students' moms is a music teacher, and she filled in for me this last week. Mrs. Reisner, and then several other teachers and sponsors that went, and parents. And our junior high students did very well. We took our choral group, took second in the state, and we had several other things take first place, like acting and a piano duet and a speech and photography. Grayson took second with his euphonium and brass solo in the state. And we had several other places, I think 9 total places for our junior high, and they did extremely well. So I'm very proud of them. Wish I could have gone, but very pleased with how well they did. And we have several of those guys in our church, and they did really well this last week. So get a chance to see the Curtises or Abraham or Grayson. Make sure you congratulate them for their hard work this last week. Well, let's take our hymnal and sing one more time. 384, to whom much has been given. Let's stand together as we sing. Hymn number 384.
We gather in God's presence to worship Him this hour. We honor and exalt Him. We kneel to Him in prayer. Our words are but a silence unless we do as He desires. For to whom much has been given, much more shall be required. To whom much has been given, much more shall be required. You have given gold and silver. Will you give to Him your lives? Will you labor with your Savior? Will you do as He desires? For to whom much has been given, much more shall be required. To seek the lost and hungry and feed them with His word, to reach out to our enemies and embrace them with His love. Empowered and commissioned, so we must do as he desires. For too much has been given, much more shall be required. Too much has been given, much more shall be required. You have given gold and silver. Will you give to him your lives? Will you labor with your Savior? Will you do as he desires? For to whom much has been given, much more shall be required.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Do you need help here? Are you okay? Pastor Chip is just practicing here. One thing you can say about Pastor Chip, he's smooth, isn't he? Look at that. Look at that. Yeah, okay. We're all watching you, Pastor Chip, so be careful. Be very careful as you go down. Yeah, let's give him a good round of applause. He thought going down might be a little harder. I said, just put your helmet on and hang on. So I just, you know, and enjoy. The surgery's tomorrow afternoon. We'll pray that that is successful. We're thankful for the outlook when he went to the doctor this week. And it's not as severe as they had initially thought. The swelling was too much for them to do surgery until that swelling goes down. And so that's why they scheduled it for tomorrow. That's tomorrow afternoon. So pray for Pastor Chip and the family and pray for the surgeon as they put everything back together. I have on the screen a picture of an artist's depiction of persecution in the times of the Roman Empire. It's a painting. Maybe the Colosseum or some other amphitheater or stadium there. If you notice very, very carefully, you can see these pillars all the way around, and these in the back have been lit already, and these are individuals. And historians tell us that they took Christians and rolled them in pitch and put them on spikes and on crosses and used them, lit them, and used them as torches and fires to illuminate as they had their nighttime activities and contests that were there. You can see that in the sand of the Colosseum floor, the track marks from the chariots and so on and the various things. Here we have the Christians huddled together around their leader here, huddled together, and we have the hungry beast coming up for them. I think the tiger might be a little stretch, but history records that this is what happened. This is what happened to believers in the early centuries of the church. Early centuries of the church. I want to speak to you today from John chapter 15. If you have your Bibles, let's turn there. John chapter 15, verses 18 through 27. We've been working our way through Christ's discourse here. And I want to speak to you this morning on hated without a cause. Hated without a cause. John chapter 15, verses 18 through 27. This passage is very different from the previous passages. This passage from the pen of John the Apostle under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, very different than what we read in his first epistle as he wrote. He is the apostle of love and very different from what he wrote. I draw your attention, John chapter 15, beginning with verse 18. You read with me. Let's read together John chapter 15, verses 18 through 27. You read that with me. Ready? If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, then is Lord, if they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin. But now they have no cloak for their sin. He that hateth me hateth my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which none other man did, they had not had sin. But now have they had both seen and hated both me and my Father. But this cometh to pass, that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law, they hated me without a cause. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to open the Bible this morning and to preach your word. This is an unusual passage, very different. And we pray that you would give us understanding. Pray that from this passage we would be challenged. Pray that from this passage we would be instructed how we should live our lives and our relationship with the world. So use your word to speak to our hearts today, and we'll thank you for it, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Why does Jesus speak these words to his disciples? Well, he wanted to prepare them for what was ahead. Individuals we care about and concern about, and they're facing some sort of trial or some sort of test. We want to tell them what to expect and what to look out for. When I have a family come in and they're interested in putting their child or children into our school, I always sit down with them, walk through who we are and what we're doing, and so on and so forth. Then I say, look, the first 9 weeks are going to be very tough for your student. First 9 weeks. And the way that we do things, the rules that we have, the structure that we have, the academics that we have, hey, they're going to be asked to do homework. And they're going to be expected to have their work done and be on time, be respectful for the teachers. It's going to be difficult for them for the first 9 weeks. Mom and Dad, you got to hang in there, because the first 9 weeks will be hard. I'm being honest with them. Someone who has never been in our school before and now comes into our school needs to understand it's not like where they've been. It's different, and it will be hard, and the academics will be tough, and we have high standards. And so we want to warn them, want to prepare them. Met with the juniors, and the juniors are looking forward to becoming seniors and graduating and all that kind of stuff. And we talked to them about the ACT test or the SAT test. Those are the tests that are required that the colleges look at for entrance qualifications and that kind of thing. So look, this test is a five-hour test, and you need to be prepared for this test. I encourage you to do this and this and this. This is when I think you should take it. It's most advantageous for you to take it here because of this and this and this. And what are we trying to do? We're trying to help them. We want to prepare them as best we can to help them for what they're going to face. So we give some instruction to help them. Jesus is trying to prepare his disciples. He is not going to be with them. And they're sorrowful, right? Let not your heart be troubled. And they are sorrowful because he's told them, I go away. And when he goes away, they are going to face some stuff that they haven't faced before, and he's trying to tell them. In fact, the Lord Jesus is being very kind and helpful, and history bears out that all of the apostles, except for John the apostle, died a martyr's death. They were hated. They were persecuted. They were killed. And this is not my sermon this morning, but you can walk through the list of the apostles and see Jesus is warning them they're going to hate you. And they did. It happened exactly like the Lord Jesus said. Simon Peter was crucified. Tradition says, Simon said, I'm not worthy to be crucified like my Lord. Crucify me upside down. And so they did. They crucified him upside down. Andrew crucified. James, Acts tells us, was beheaded by Herod Agrippa. John, the brother of James, this is John the Apostle, probably the only one that wasn't martyred. But he was exiled on the Isle of Patmos. That's where he wrote the book of Revelation, the Apocalypse, for us. He suffered persecution. Matthew, tradition says, died in Ethiopia. Bartholomew, beaten and then crucified. Philip, crucified. Thomas, speared to death. Many say in India. Simon the Zealot, crucified. James and Thaddeus, stoned to death. Jesus is trying to help them. Jesus is trying to help them. And history bears out they needed it. They needed this instruction that he gives to them. As we consider this, we need to understand how this applies to us as well. Spoken very specifically to the disciples because they needed it. Notice the outline here in John chapter 15. We have Christ and his disciples, verses 1 through 17. And it begins with the vine and the branches. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. And we go through verse 16. You have not chosen me. I have chosen you and ordained you that you should bring forth fruit. These things I command you, that you love one another. We have Christ and his disciples. Then we have the passage that we just read, verses 18 through 27. This is the disciples and the world, their relationship to the world. Christ in his relationship to the disciples, he is the vine, they are the branches. Now the disciples and their relationship to the world. And if you'll take your finger and look over at chapter 16, you'll see the disciples and their relationship with the Holy Spirit. Great instruction and teaching on the Holy Spirit in John chapter 16. I want you to notice how sharp the contrast is here. When he talks about Christ and his disciples, we can divide these 17 verses into two chunks and basically two commands. The first command is abide in me. He talks about the vine and the branches, and we considered that last time. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Now you are clean through the word. Abide in me, verse 4, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself. I am the vine, ye are the branches, he that abideth in me. And so command number one is to abide in Christ, abide in Christ. And in these eight verses, seven times we have the word abide. It's used more times than that. We pointed that out last week in this whole passage. But in these eight verses, we have the word abide seven times. Here's the command. Abide in him. Us in our relationship to Christ, abide in him. We come to verse 9, and look at verse 9 through 17. And here he's talking about love. This is very characteristic of the Apostle John, known as the Apostle of Love. It is said that when he was old and no longer able to walk, they carried him into the church services, into the assembly. John, do you have a word to speak to us? And his word was love one another. Love one another. That's what tradition and the historians tell us. Twice in this passage, we have the command, verse 12 and verse 17, these things I command you that ye love one another. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. And if you'll take your finger as you run through the column on your Bible, or be careful you don't mess it up as you run your finger down your electronics, notice nine times he uses the word love in these verses 9 through 17. Nine times he uses the word love. And so he talks about abiding me. That's obvious. That's obvious what he's talking about. The number of times that word is used. And then love, loving God, loving one another. And that's obvious as you see that. But then you come to verse 18. And in verse 18, the subject switches. The apostle of love stops talking about love and switches to hate. Notice how many times the word is used here in this passage. 8 times the word hate is used in these verses. Clearly the subject, what he's talking about. And he switches from love, loving God, loving one another, to hate. The world is going to hate you. The world is going to hate you. And he switches to that. Notice, if the world, verse 18, if the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. Notice that verse 19. But I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. There's a stark contrast in the subject. Can you understand that? Very, very clear change of subject. So here he's talking about the apostles and their relationship to the world. And he's telling them ahead of time, this is what is going to happen. Now we use the word world. We need to understand exactly what that means. And it's the word cosmos in the Greek. Very, very common word, familiar word. And it's used a variety of different ways. And the context helps us to determine the meaning. In John chapter 3 and verse 16, for God so loved the cosmos, the world. He's not talking about the globe or the planet. He's talking about humanity, those that inhabit the earth. He's talking about a mankind. God so loved the people, the mass of humanity. And so there the word world, cosmos, means people. Here in John chapter 15, he's talking about a humanistic system, the world humanistic system. The world has a value system. It is corrupt. It is bankrupt. It is anti-God, anti-Christian, anti-Bible, and there's a world system that is in operation. And this is what he's talking about, the corrupt value system that is at war with God, at war with God. That's what he's talking about when he talks about the world. There's much we could say about that. Let me just give you 2 thoughts about the world. Number one, the world is under the influence of Satan. Satan guides and directs this world system. Satan is called the god of this world. I have the verse on the screen, 2 Corinthians 4. If our gospel be hid, it is hid from them that are lost, in whom the god of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ... excuse me, who is the image of God, should shine in them. Satan is the god of this world, and the world system that operates around us, that is corrupt, that is anti-God, is under the influence of Satan. Secondly, we can say very simply is that the world system has some very powerful weapons. John talks about that in 1 John chapter 2. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. It is anti-God. And so the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life are these powerful weapons that Satan uses in his influence, using the world system and to accomplish his goals and his plans and his objectives. So when we come to this passage, there's a complete shift in thinking from love to hate, from doing the will of God to not being involved with the world and how the world will treat you. In this text, Jesus tells us three reasons why the world hates us as Christians, why it hates the apostles, why it hates the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice, if you would, verse 19. The first reason is because true Christians are not of this world. True Christians are not of this world. Many people who go by the name Christian, we're not talking about those. We're talking about true believers, genuine believers. Are you a Christian? Or are you a Muslim? Okay, and so many people go, well, I'm a Christian. That doesn't mean they're a genuine believer. True believers, those who have placed their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, those who love the Lord Jesus Christ and desire to live for him, are not of this world. Look at verse 19. Jesus said, the world will hate you. It hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world was love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. You are not of this world. He states here that the world can only love his own things, I think is the right way to understand that. That's not a masculine or a feminine there. That's neuter. He's talking about its own things. So the world has its own religion, has its own philosophy, has its own music, has its own language, has its own speech, has its own science. And the world loves its own thing. The world loves itself, and the world wants to please itself. And that's what the world loves. And anybody that is contrast to that, anything that is contrary to that, the world hates. The world loves itself and the things that it promotes. But if you're not of that, it hates you. It hates you. Isn't it interesting that the world screams at us as believers to be tolerant? You need to be tolerant. Oh, you need to accept the homosexuals. You need to accept the transgender. You need to do that. We're getting transgender stuff crammed down our throat. And we see it all the time. And they're screaming at us to accept it. We got to accept it. Oh, we're leaving and doing all that kind of stuff. But when we stand up and say what is right and what is true, this is not reasonable. It's not logical. It's not natural. It's not right. When we stand up, they hate us. Why? Because we are not following what they love. We are not accepting what they love. They want us to be tolerant. We stand for the truth, simply state the truth, and they hate us. They hate us for the truth, We speak the truth, and they hate us. Go on a college campus, and you can see all kinds of perversion and all kinds of governmental positions and all kinds of different things being promoted. But a Christian goes and hands out tracts and begins distributing or stands and they're to do that kind of stuff. They get run off campus. They get run off campus. Why? Because that's not of the world system. That's not of the world system. I know several good men here in town, youth pastors and other things, who have tried to have lunch over at Pekin High School. Well, Pekin High School has everything else in it that you can think of, but they won't allow the youth pastor to come in and have lunch with his kids. Why is that? Because it's not of their system. And they hate it. And they hate us for it. They hate us. We stand for what is right and what is true because we are not of their system. They hate us. They hate us. That's what Jesus says in verse 19. Notice what Jesus says in verse 20. Second reason, the world hates us because the world hated our Lord. We've accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. We claim Him as Lord. And the world hated our Lord. Therefore, because we love the Lord, they hate us. They hate us. Look at verse 18. Verse 18. If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. Look at verse 20. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. They have persecuted me. They will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. They hated the Lord. They persecuted him. We love the Lord. They hate us. They will persecute us. One of the great verses of the Apostle Paul is Philippians 3, verse 10. The Apostle Paul says, that I may know him, Christ, and the power of his resurrection. I'd like to stop right there. But the next phrase says, and the fellowship of his suffering. That's what he's talking about here. If you stand for righteousness and you stand for truth and you stand for the Lord Jesus Christ, you will fellowship in his suffering. They hated him, they will hate you. They hated him, they will hate you. 1 Peter 3:21 says, Bible says that Christ has left us an example of his suffering. I'm slaughtering this. But, he has left for us an example that you should walk in his steps. But when he was reviled, reviled not again. And so they abused him, and they slandered him, and they persecuted him, and he trusted in the one who will bring ultimate deliverance. And he has set for us, Christ has set for us a standard, an example, that we should walk in his steps. They hated him. They hated him without a cause. They hated him, and as we follow Christ, they will hate us as well. There's a third reason. Look at verse 21. Verse 21. The world hates us because the world does not know God. Does not know God. All these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. They don't know God. Now, they should have known God. And they should have known that Jesus Christ is God the Son. They should have known that Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. They should have known, the Jews in particular, should have known that Jesus was the Messiah, the promised Messiah. Look what Jesus says here in verse 22. He said, I have spoken unto them the words that I have spoken unto them. They should have realized by the words that I said. Remember what the the religious leaders sent individuals to arrest the Lord Jesus Christ, and they came back empty-handed, and they reported to the religious leaders, and they said what? Never man spoke as this man spoke, for he spoke as one with authority. And a religious leader said, what? Are you deceived as well? They should have known the words of Christ were true and right, and the authority, the word of God, they should have known. He talks about the works. Look at here, verse 24. I've done the works, these miracles that nobody else could do. They should have known by my words and my works that I am God the Son. I am the Messiah. I am the Christ. They should have known that. Nicodemus came to Jesus by night, and he said, no man can do the miracles that you do except he be a man of God. Except God be with him. And Nicodemus was smart enough to realize that this man is divinely empowered. There's something special about him. Jesus said, you must be born again. But he recognized that because of the miracles that Jesus did, they should have known. They should have known. Jesus said, because of the words that I have spoken and because of the works that I have done, the miracles that I have done, you are without excuse. There's no covering. You have nothing to cover your sin. There's no excuse. I've revealed it. I've spoken to you, and I've exposed your sin for what it is. You are without excuse, is what Jesus is saying. The world does not know God. They do not know God. The Jews thought they knew God, but they rejected his Son. And Jesus says, those that reject the Son also reject the Father. That's verses 23 and 24. If you reject God the Son, you reject God the Father. And those who reject one reject the other. And then we come to verse 25, where he quotes from the Old Testament. Three times in the book of Psalms, we have this statement, they hated me without a cause. Is there any reason to hate the Lord Jesus Christ? Is there any reason at all? Did the Lord Jesus Christ ever cheat anybody? Did the Lord Jesus Christ ever tell a lie? Was the Lord Jesus Christ ever unkind? I mean, you go through the life of the Lord Jesus Christ and you see there's no reason whatsoever anyone should ever hate the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet they killed him. They killed him. Why? Because he exposed their sin. He told them the truth. And they didn't like it. They hated him without a cause. They hated him without a cause. You know what he's saying? If we stand for Christ and we live for Christ and we speak the truth, they'll hate us. We don't want to give them cause to hate us. We don't want to do foolishness. We're opposed to abortion, but we don't bomb abortion centers. We're opposed to abortion, but we don't kill abortion doctors. We're opposed to that, and we speak against that, and we speak the truth. Life begins at conception, and we are very strongly pro-life because God is pro-life. But we don't give them reason to reject us. They hated him without a cause. They hated him without a cause. Okay, Pastor, I see that. Okay, so how should we live? I'm glad you asked. Let me give you three words, real quickly, three words. Us in our relationship to the world, what is it? First thing is separation. We need to be separated from the world, separated from the world. Look at verse 19. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you, what? Out of the world. Therefore the world hates you. We are to be separate from the world. We are to be separate from the world. Romans 12, 1 and 2, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not, what? Conformed to this world. Don't be pressed into its mold. Don't be shaped and influenced by the world. We got a lot of influencers out there. That's a big thing these days. Influencer, and how many I got following me? Don't be influenced by the world. Separate from the world. Be not conformed to this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Paul writes in Ephesians, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. Speak out against them. Rebuke them. Don't fellowship with them. It's so easy for us to get sucked in to the things of the world. It's so easy for us to compromise because we're getting pressured on every side. Every side. And we need to be careful and stand our ground and be true biblicists and biblical Christians and be separated from the world. There's so much that could be said here. I quoted 1 John 2 a moment ago, love not the world. Okay, love not the world. We're to separate it, we're separate from it. Not only don't love it, but don't be a friend of it. James tells us that he that is the friend of the world is the enmity of God. Fellowship with the world is enmity with God. We become the enemy of God. The world is temporary and passed away, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. They're in contrast one to the other. The world is anti-God, anti-Christ, anti-Bible. And so we need to be separated. Practice separation, personal separation. Practice that. Live a holy life. Be separated from the things of the world. Second world, not just separation, but opposition. Opposition. Look at verse 20. We should expect this. In the United States, we've been spared some of this kind of persecution and so on and so forth, but the way things are going and its snowball is rolling very quickly down the hill now, and the way our society is very quickly heading, if the Lord tarries, we stand for truth, we may have to face some of this. It's common around the world. It's common. Those that study missions and these kind of things tell us that there's more persecution taking place in this day and age than ever before in world history. Ever before. And the last century has seen more martyrdoms and more persecution for the cause of Christ than ever before. And we've been spared that here in the United States. We need to understand that we should expect this if we'll stand for the truth. If we're willing to identify with Christ and speak the truth, because the world hates the truth. Jesus said the servant is not greater than his master. They hated me, they will hate you. We should expect that. Jesus taught this. The last of the Beatitudes, blessed are they when men persecute you and revile against you. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely, for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. Jesus taught this. He gave this warning to the apostles, And he taught this in the Beatitudes. This is our calling. Brothers and sisters, this is our calling. If the Lord tarries, we stand true to him. We stand true to him. We will face this. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, Peter said. We try to make Christianity acceptable to the world, and we try to candy coat it a little bit, and we need to hold to the truth, speak the truth. Speak the truth in love, but we need to speak the truth. We need to speak the truth. Don't make the world try to love the Lord Jesus Christ. The world doesn't love the Lord Jesus Christ, and the world hates you for being a hypocrite. Don't do that. Stand for truth. Stand for truth and do that which is right. So we should separate from the world. We should expect opposition from the world. And our third term is this, proclamation. Proclamation. I draw your attention to verses 26 and 27. The Bible says very simply here that we are to be witnesses, and you also shall bear witness. You shall bear witness. Do you know what the Greek word for witness is? I have it on the screen there. It's from the word martos in the Greek. We got, what English word do we get from that? The word martyr. The word witness literally is the Greek word martyr. Initially, anybody who testified for Christ was a martos, a witness. But that word took on special meaning because witnesses for Christ were killed so frequently that we think of martyrs as one who dies for the cause of Christ. As a witness, you need to be willing to die for the cause of Christ. That's what the word means. That's what the word means. We are to be witnesses. We are to proclaim the truth. We are to shine the light in a very dark world. In a very dark world, we are to speak the truth of God. Notice in these verses, the Comforter is come, I will send from the Father the Spirit of truth. He shall testify of me. You also shall bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. I think we can say this, our witness is of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus said, he shall testify of me, and you will do the same thing. Our witness is of Jesus Christ. That's what we proclaim. We're not proclaiming our social program or a political agenda or party. We're to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who died for our sins and arose from the dead. Our witnesses of our Savior, Jesus Christ, from God the Father, through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit will empower us. The Holy Spirit will give us the words. The Holy Spirit will work in the heart of the one to whom we're speaking. And we need to pray that the seed that we plant, the seed that we give, the seed of the Word of God about our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, will fall on good soil. And the Holy Spirit can use that to bring salvation. And we witness to the world. There's a lost and dying world. We're separate from the world. We're not going to be sucked into the world and its system and its powers and its philosophy and its religion. You see that? We see it all the time. See it all the time, the world system. And we're separate from that. But to the lost and the dying, we proclaim the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. We proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it alone is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Some will accept, and some will receive. And we rejoice in that. Many will hate us for it because they love their sin and they promote their sin and they're interested in their own sin and their own lifestyle, and they will hate us for the truth that we proclaim. Romans chapter 1 talks about this great catalog of sins that are there. And then at the end of the chapter it says they not only do these things, but they revel in it. Do you remember when you saw the first gay parade? Oh, that was shocking. Do you remember that? It's flaunted in our face everywhere, even in legislatures. chant, the trans group is chanting and disrupting and so on and so forth. It's everywhere. They're celebrating sin. They want to say it's okay to mutilate and medicate children. It's wrong. It's sinful. It's evil. You oppose that, and they hate you for it. And you have a choice. You can go and hunker down in your bunker, keep your head in the sand, or you can stand up and say, no, that's not right. Let me tell you, you can be saved by grace through faith. We need to stand for righteousness and stand for truth. And we need to proclaim the gospel. That's the only hope that this world has. That's the only hope they have. Don't expect the world to love you. Don't expect the world to love you. Some, by the grace of God, amen, some will believe. Some will listen. Some will engage. Most will not. Most will not. Pastor, how can I do this? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's close with this. God the Father is going to assist you. The world is temporary, the Bible says, and the things of the world, they pass away. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever, and the love of God is eternal. Look, what's happening here is just very temporary. You need to think of the big picture. What will eternity be like? And you need to live for eternity, not just the little world here. God the Father, the love of God the Father and the grace of God the Father and the will of God the Father is eternal, abides forever. The things of this earth, they're just temporary. They pass away. Secondly, Jesus Christ said, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. That's at the end of the next chapter. I won't preach to that point today. Okay? Notice at the end, verse 33. In this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. I'm glad for that, aren't you? Yeah, we're going to face tough times, difficult times. Jesus said, I've overcome the world. And then God the Holy Spirit helps us. Greater is he that is in you. Who is in us? The Holy Spirit of God. Greater is he that is in you than he that is what? In the world. I'm glad for that. We're on the victory sign. We're in the victory sign. You ask the apostles if they regret living for Christ, and many of them ended up by giving their life for Christ. You ask them if they regret it, and they'll say, are you kidding me? I wish I had another life to give. I wish I had another life to give. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Dearly beloved, we need to live for God. We need to stand for truth and righteousness. Not everybody's going to love us. In fact, most people, if we stand for truth and righteousness, they will hate us. They hated him, they'll hate us. They'll hate us. God has promised to reward us if we stay faithful. Can we do that? Yes, we can. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit will help us to do what is right. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity. This is not easy preaching. I'd much rather preach on love than hate. And I don't like to be called hateful, and yet we have been accused of that. But we know that if we stand for what is right and what is true, then the world will hate us because we're opposing their sinful lifestyle and their wickedness and their pleasures and their passions and their lusts. It's no wonder you've told us to love one another because the world's not going to love us. But inside the family of God, we should find acceptance and love. We should embrace that. We should love one another and encourage one another because we are living in difficult days. So help us. Help us to love you supremely. Help us to love one another. Help us to love and stand for the truth. Speak to our hearts, embolden us, we pray, and we'll thank you for it, for we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing a verse or two of a hymn before we're dismissed. Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please him in all that I do. Let's stand together and we'll sing a verse or two. This is a closing hymn. It's also our hymn of invitation, which means if the Lord's spoken to your heart, you need to respond. or there's something, that decision you've made you need to make public, or something you have a question about, inquiry about, I need some help with, we invite you to come. This is the opportunity for you to respond in that way, and we invite you to come. Let's sing Living for Jesus, A Life That Is True. Questions, let me help you with that. Let's talk through that. Okay, I want to be a help and a blessing to you. I want to prepare you for what the Lord has for us if he tarries his coming. Let's be dismissed with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ and the salvation that we enjoy through him. Thank you for the Holy Spirit who indwells us and empowers us, who illumines us and teaches us the truth. Help us to know the truth and stand for the truth, and help us to live a righteous life in this very wicked and perverse and dark and ungodly day and age. And so I pray that you'd help us not to be friends or fall in love with the world, but to love God and love his word and to love his people and to proclaim his truth. Guide and direct us, we pray, help us. And dismiss us now with thy blessing. Have time to fellowship together and some Bible study together. We ask for your continued blessing, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.